Okay.
You got ready, man.
So yesterday's, in the last class, we discussed three things. We first discussed the evolution operator quantum mechanics in terms of the path integral. We then discussed how the evolution operator and the theory of a scalar field can be written in terms of quantum mechanics. And then in the last class, part of the last class, we discussed how if we wrote down the evolution operator for a putative theory of electromagnetism in terms of a path integral over the Maxwell action, then we could find an interpretation of the Hilbert space over which it computed a transition amplitude. Any questions or comments about this? Any questions or comments or discussion about this?
Very last part of the lecture, the place where you will actually explain the projection onto the gauge invariant sector of the wave functional, it was the expression e to the minus I h t which was being discussed rather than the action.
Yes. Let's go through that again. So, what we need is to study the path integral in the pi periodics. Okay. What was our convention? F mu mu F zero I was negative slope.
Then F mu mu is equal to del mu mu A mu zero.
Okay. Let's just remind ourselves what we about the logic. Okay? What we do is take this path integral and slice it along length of constant time. This is a path integral, we slice along some constant time. Okay. And then we try to find a Hilbert space interpretation of this path integral. Now, we notice that this path integral could be written in the form f0i by 2 plus minus fij by 4. Every index is on the form. Okay? This part, okay. And then we decided that we will do the integral in the following way. dA0 times integral dA of this action. Okay? We had a hard time giving a Hilbert space interpretation to pull up half of it because A0 did not come with a kinetic term. So we didn't know how to give a Hilbert space interpretation of the path integral over A0. Because the one case that we had understood, namely that of quantum mechanics, every path integral came with kinetic. So since that's all we know, we didn't know what to do with A0. So we decided to be pragmatic. What we decided to do is, let's do the path integral over AI first. As far as that path integral goes, it's a standard action. Because F0 AI is, you know, has kinetic terms. As del 0 AI goes next way. Okay? And then we would do the path integral over A0 later. The first observation was that the path integral over AI could by itself be given a simple Hilbert space interpretation. Okay? Just because AI is all completely standard, we get the same interpretation as we did for the scalar field. In particular, well, this is a transition amplitude on a space, you know, between on a Hilbert space, whose where the Hilbert space is wave functionals of three scalar fields A1, A2, and E3. Three is greater than three by something, E minus one. Right? Now, there was Hilbert space, but this path integral was computing something in that Hilbert space. What was it computing? Okay? What it was computing, as always, is e to the power minus ihd. Okay? So now what we did was that this e to the power ix, this was computing an evolution of it. Is this clear? an evolution operator in the Hilbert space of three fields, of built out of A1, A2, and A3. Square integrable functions, of functionals of A1, A2, and A3. So, what we want to do, and then this is an integral over some functions. So what we want to do is write down what this was computing. Okay? So this was computing just simply e to the power minus I h t. But what was h? Okay? Now, in order to obtain that h, we just follow the usual rules. The usual rules of the path integral tell us that the h is the h that you get from, you know, the canonical classical procedure. So we just follow the classical procedure. Okay? How did we follow it? H has a term that is plus minus the Lagrange. So there is a Fij by 4 minus F0i by 2. This is one of the terms in H. The other term is Q dot P. Q dot is AI dot P equal F0i. Okay? But now, AI dot is the same thing as del 0 AI. And this term and this term are very similar. So to make them properly similar, I added and subtracted del I 0 times F0i. So then I have that plus del I 0. Okay? And then I remember that this guy is F0i itself, and F0i is simply pi. So, since I want to write down an operator, I'll write it down in operator language. I'll write it down as a function of a's and pi's. Fij is a function of pi's, so I've identified my h. Okay? H is equal to my Hamiltonian h is equal to fij by 4 plus pi I squared by 2 plus del I is 0. Is this clear? Okay. So then what's happening is that what we're doing is computing the transition amplitude in an Hilbert space we know. With the Hamiltonian that we know. But of course the problem depends on A0. So we've not yet done the path integral of the A0. As far as this auxiliary problem doing the AI path integral is concerned, A0 is some background field. Okay? Now, it's nice that we solved the auxiliary problem, but that's not what we started out trying to do. We started out trying to find the path integral interpretation of the full path integral, including the path integral of the A0. Okay? So now, what we have to do is, in addition, do the path integral of A0. Notice that A0 acts at every value of space as well as every value of time. Okay? So, now what I'm going to do is to understand. Just let's take the path integral at one particular time over A0 and try to understand what that is. Okay? That we argued, this path, firstly we argued that this operator and this operator is commutative in nature. So you could write exponential of e to the power I h t as exponential of, you know, you just separate the two exponentials. Product of two expressions. Okay? And then we argued that the path integral over A0 was a projection operator. Okay? It acted on wave functions in the following way. Or more precisely, once we normalized, it would be a projection. It acted on wave functions in the following way. Suppose we had psi AI. Once we act with path integral over A0 of, so now I define the operator P, which is some normalization, times
e to the power I del 0 f 0 I, okay, integral dA zero. And any all this at any given point in space. Sorry, at given point in time. Okay, how did this operator I turn Hilbert space? Okay, it took psi of AI and gave you instead psi of AI plus del I A0 integrated over all A0. Okay, now what does this do? What this does, so let me define this action. AI goes to AI plus del I of lambda, where lambda is a function just of space, as the action of what I'm going to call a gauge transformation. Okay? It's clear that this integral projects you onto gauge invariant states. Those states, those psi's that have the property that psi of AI is equal to psi of AI plus D0 lambda. Plus the I lambda. How do you prove that? Well, suppose I looked at psi of AI plus the I lambda. I now write this as DI of A0 plus lambda. And then I do a change of variables inside the integral. To rewrite A0 prime is A0 plus lambda. So I've got back the same state. Okay. Now, of course, when we're doing path integrals, there's always some normalization issue, some overall normalization, which, as you remember, we don't care about. Okay, so up to normalizations, what is this operator? It's a projection operator. Okay, what's a projection operator? Projection operator in any Hilbert space is an operator that obeys is an operator P such that P squared is equal to P. Why is this a projection operator? That's very simple. It's because, you know, what does the operator do? It projects every wave function onto a gauge invariant sector. Now suppose you acted once with a projection operator on any wave function. You've got a gauge invariant wave function. Now, if you act again with that same projection operator, it doesn't do anything. Because the wave function was already gauge invariant. Of course, there could be normalization. Apart from the normalization which we promote. Okay, it's a projection. You see, so what this tells you is the following. What this tells you is that when we actually do the path integral, at each time slice, what we're actually getting is the following. What we get, you break up your time into little bits as we do, and then what you get is e to the power minus I h, where h now is just this h. Okay? Delta t, so this times, let's say, some projector. Times projector times e to the power minus I h delta t. Times projector, and so on. Because at each time slice, let's say 0. Now this looks like a lot of projectors. Okay, but we've seen many things about these projectors. Firstly, we've seen that this projector commutes through the Hamiltonian. Because it commutes for any value of A0, therefore commutes through the integral. Remember, A0 is a number. Okay? Now, since you can commute the projector through all these A0s, you can commute them either all to the left or all to the right or wherever you want. Let's commute them all to the left. Then, of this magnificent property that the projector is projective. So though we have an infinite number of copies of the projector, they all square to each other. Up to this normalization. Normalization is sometimes called the volume of the gauge group, which is of course infinite. And it will trouble us as we go get it forgotten. But if we are ignoring the normalization, then it's just present the projector. So now what do we see? What we see is that our path integral computes a very simple transition amplitude in a very simple Hilbert space.
It was a very simple Hamiltonian. The Hilbert space is one we discussed. Three-way functions. Hamiltonian is the one we discussed. This guy. However, the path integral we're computing comes equipped automatically with a projector. What does it project us onto? Projects us onto the subspace of Hilbert space. Okay? That is gauge invariant. So the Hilbert space interpretation of our path integral is now clear. Okay? It's a path integral with three ARIs. The Hilbert space made up of the Hilbert space of three scalar fields, subject to the one constraint, and with the Hamiltonian, but subject to the constraint that we would only look at that sector of the path of the Hilbert space, that is, that obeys condition of gauge invariance. Now you can ask, is this consistent? You know, if you put any old projection onto a Hilbert space, it's not consistent with dynamics. Because if you start with some projection, let's say I choose to, I'm doing quantum mechanics, and I say, look, there's this region in space, and I will project to that subset of Hilbert space such that the particle is in this region of space. That's a consistent thing to do. To start with, I mean, there's a consistent projector. You can take this operator and integrate it over any volume you want. That gives you a projector, as you can easily prove this. Okay? However, it's not consistent to do dynamics with such a projection. So because if you're dealing with a free particle, if you started with a state that obeyed this projection, very soon, in fact, in infinitesimal time, every state will not obey the projection. And then you would have to give a definition of your dynamics. Okay? What's the reason for that? The reason for that is that this projection does not commute with the Hamiltonian. And so it did commute, of course, e to the power ht goes through the projector. Okay? So, in our case, we've not imposed any old projector. We've projected by a projector that does commute with the Hamiltonian. Precisely because the Hamiltonian is by itself gauge invariant. And so what we've done is consistent. So it's consistent to study not just kinematics, but also dynamics subject to this projection. And what I mean by consistency, I mean that if we impose this projection at one time, we've automatically imposed it at all times. We've already seen this in our derivation. This projector here, at each time step, was projecting onto the same. We're constantly projecting you back onto your space. But then we saw we didn't need to do that. This was just predicted. Okay? So now we've come up with a beautiful interpretation, a beautiful Hilbert space interpretation of our path integral. The Hilbert space interpretation is what we said. Simple Hilbert space, simple Hamiltonian, but subject to projection.
If it's not commuting with the Hamiltonian, then we would have to be constantly projecting onto the...
We would have to be constantly projecting, and then we would have to understand what the effective dynamics of this. Yeah, so it would be sort of like, but you know, it'll never happen. These kind of path integrals that give you this kind of projector are always equipped with an invariance. Right? So, the problem would be this. It would be a lack of unitary. Okay? If what you were saying. Because you see, suppose you've got a state of norm. So you've got some wave function here. It spreads out. And then you project. You, the norm of your wave function is not preserved. Okay? Then you would find it very hard to make things consistent with such an evolution. Consistent with the probability interpretation of quantum mechanics. Okay? I'm not saying it's impossible, I'm not saying it's a theorem, but you find it very hard. Okay? And this does not happen when we study quantum mechanics. See, suppose we were doing this quantum mechanics example, projecting onto some region. Now, suppose our rule was that we evolve over an infinitesimal time and just project out that part of the wave function that does not live in our space. Then evolve and project out its time. Okay? if this was removed by itself, it doesn't preserve the norm. As you can see. Because the norm is mod psi squared over all space. And if you throw out mod psi over some parts of space, mod psi squared keeps shape. Now you can try to make this consistent by rescaling psi. But you're in great danger of losing the linearity of quantum mechanics. I mean, this is a very slippery slope. One could try to do this. It's difficult to make it consistent.
It seems to me that the B-tradition is infinite in Hamiltonian. Aren't we free to choose a gauge condition? Don't we have different gauge conditions?
Yeah. Okay. Yes. So, as we will see in evaluating this path integral, as we go along the course, in evaluating the path integral, we will find ourselves free to insert delta functions that pick out different gauge conditions. But these, there are two separate issues that I want to separate. The first question is this. Suppose we just have the path integral, perhaps on a lattice, okay, based on this action, with no gauge condition. I have not chosen any gauge condition. I'm just doing this path integral. Then you can ask, what is the quantum Hilbert space interpretation of this path integral? I've not mentioned the word gauge in the statement of the problem. Okay? And by following the rules, by quantizing on constant time slices, you're led to this interpretation. Now, there are various manipulations of the path integral that one can do, which are invariances of the path integral. Okay? And we will study these as we go along. But only up.
Each of these lead to evaluation.
Each of these lead to the same path integral. So this path integral is computing this thing. Okay? Now there are manipulations you can do to compute the path integrals in different ways. As we will understand. But this is what's computing. Actually, there's one other interesting Hilbert space interpretation of gauge theory, namely the interpretation with BRST. We will discuss this and show that it. But the justification of that will be to show that it's equivalent. This is what the path integral gives you. All the rest is mathematics. This is what you get, in my opinion. Now, I have to say that I have not seen a field theory textbook that discusses quantization of gauge theories in this way. And perhaps this is because I'm missing something, but I think it's because they're all missing something. This is just by far the easiest way, far the cleanest way, in my opinion, to understand the quantization of gauge theory. It doesn't talk about fixing a gauge, it doesn't talk about any, you know, all kinds of very artificial things, sort of like, you know, the answer, like push it in the framework. This is totally clean, in my opinion. You start and you follow the rules that you give.
This is actually technical. The place where you actually introduce a pi array variable into the Hamiltonian. How do you incorporate the path integral over pi array into action?
Okay, so there are two answers to this question. Firstly, you can, right? If you remember our derivation of the path integral in quantum mechanics, at an intermediate stage, what we had was the path integral over pq dot minus h of pq. Okay? This pi is that p. So firstly, you could do it. Yeah. But secondly, it's not me. You see, what is the logic in going from here to here? The logic is, I've given you a path integral. And I want to know, what is the Hilbert space interpretation of this? Okay? This step is a path integral. This step is not. Okay? This is just some operator. You ask, what operator in Hilbert space? And it's that operator. You understand? Having said that, you might find it more convincing if you go through the derivation of the path integral. You can do it. But it's not needed for what I want to say. I want to emphasize that. Okay? It's not like we're equating two path integrals. The upper line is a path integral. The second line is an evolution operator in Hilbert space. One computes the upper path integral, computes the matrix of this kind. Is this clear? Great. Any other questions about it?
Why don't we get a gauge condition on A0? You had explained it last week. You go through it again.
Why don't we get a gauge condition on A0? You see, because our Hilbert space did not have A0. What was a Hilbert space? It was functionals of 3 AIs. Okay? Now, because the Hilbert space is square integrable wave functionals of AIs, yeah, there cannot be a condition for A0. It's a condition of wave functions.
Yes, sir. I'm not sure if it's right, but I would rather say that we are integrating over all conditions on A0, right? And then, you split the. You split the configuration space so that into valid conditions on A0. On each condition of A0, you're getting the prediction onto the K event surface. So you actually do have the condition on A0.
What do you mean by condition on
A0? Condition on A0 would be some f of A0 equals that some arbitrary answer.
Okay, maybe there is a way of thinking of it that way. But I've not done that. All I did was do the path integral always. Okay? Yeah, it's probably true that you can equivalence this to an A0 equal to 0 or A0 or something H. It's probably true you can equivalence it. But that's trying to equivalence it with someone else's way of thinking. Okay? From the logic that we are presenting here, this stands on its own. In that logic, our Hilbert space is a function of 3 AIs. And the gauge invariance on that Hilbert space is only spatial in that gauge transformations. Okay? Yeah, it's certainly true that what we're doing is very close to what you will find in textbooks on quantization of the A0 equals into gauge. Or A0 equals something gauge. Probably just evening. But that's not needed for our presentation. Okay, fine. We'll come back to this path integral several times over the next 2 or 3 lectures as we understand path integrals better and better. Go on.
Actually, I don't know if you want to discuss it later, but I'm worried about the volume of the gauge group prisoners, because the way to regularize it would be putting it on a integer lattice, which would also have infinite volume, right? So how would you regularize
it? Well, you could work on the torus.
Huh?
You could work on a torus.
Okay,
so
but you can't. A0 is not a
smart torus,
right? A0 is a real
field. Well, suppose you were interested in a transition amplitude from one time to another. What are you talking about? You're talking about regulating
the volume,
at each. The volume of the gauge group at each point in the lattice? Or you're worried about the.
At each point in the lattice.
At each point in the lattice.
Normalization of the field.
Okay. The volume of A0 at each point in the lattice. Okay, so now as you know, one way of doing this is to do the finite group way of thinking of this thing.
Yeah, but slightly different, right?
It's a regulation of this thing, this action.
Okay.
You could ask, is there some way of writing a regulated version of this action, such that in the continuum limit goes to this action? And that, Wilson's lattice gauge theory, is a way of doing. In fact, it's what's done by lattice gauge theorists. You know, this big lattice gauge theory group here. When they compute things on their lattices, they never equal the gauge. They just regulate this in some nice way and run it on their computer. Okay? So this can be done. And in fact, is routinely done. Okay? However, we will not, in general, be particularly interested in. In our class, getting out our laptops to do lattice gauge theory. we will generally be trying to compute path integral in some formal way. Building a perturbation series, the same what we can. And in that process, the volume of the gauge group is going to hit us. So we will have to deal with it. And we'll get to it. Okay? Let me say more clearly. What is going to hit us is that there are flat directions in this action. So let me see. It's not really the volume at each point in space, but it's the. Let me say this one. As all of you know from your last course, today we have in mind, I should say I'm not trying to make this a systematic introduction to free field theory, because you know it. I'm just giving you a perspective based on path integrals. Okay. Yeah. So, as all of you know, just at the classical level, this action has an invariance. The invariance is the invariance under AMU goes to AMU plus B1. Okay. Well, now lambda is a function space. So, if you actually started trying to evaluate this integral, okay, you're going to get, without doing some proper regulation, you're going to get infinity. Because, let's break up the path integral to two parts. Let's break up the path integral over all gauge orbits. That is, all AMU, you know, any two AMUs that are related by AMU goes to AMU plus AMU lambda, I say, belong to the same gauge orbit. So let's say integrate over all gauge orbits and then over the lambdas in each gauge orbit. Let's do the integral over all gauge orbits last. Well, the integral over lambda is a path integral. But it's a path integral that's just equal to the volume of the space of the functions of lambda. Because from the fact that the path action does not depend on lambda, we see that the only place that lambda enters in the path integral is in the lambda. And that's infinite. Without careful regulation. Or such. Okay. Now, as we've discussed, we can sort of regulate this away in some way. But if we actually do the calculation, for instance, we're trying to do perturbation theory, we will find that this means, for instance, this flat direction exists even in the quadratic. And we will find that it means that the action as stated does not allow you to invert the quadratic term, because it's flat direction. So we cannot set up perturbation theory as stated. Okay? Because of that, we're going to have to deal with this. And this leads us to the kind of things you were talking about. In order to actually do analytic evaluations of this path integral, we're going to kill this volume of the gauge group. Okay? In a clever, consistent way, which we'll talk about perhaps the next lecture, maybe the last. But I know that. Okay? So we will come back to this. This volume of the gauge group will be a headache for us. We'll come back to it. Okay? But just to say that there's no in principle terrible thing about it. Okay, other questions or comments? Okay, great. So now we know how to do a path integral quantization scalar fields or scalar fields or the gauge field. Let me spend 2 minutes on gauge fields interacting with scalar fields. Okay? So suppose we have the theory of a complex scalar field. Mu phi star, mu phi. Okay? Let me be consistent. I should put a minus with our mostly negative. Supposed positive signature dimension. Okay. Now notice that this that this action has a symmetry. It has a symmetry under phasing under phi goes to pi alpha phi and phi star goes to phi alpha phi. Okay. Now, as all of you know, this symmetry is not a symmetry of the action, it's only a symmetry of the action of alpha is constant. But as all of you know, and we've discussed in great detail in previous courses, okay, once alpha is a function of position, this is no longer a symmetry of the action, but can be promoted to a symmetry of the action, in fact, can be incorporated into the gauge symmetry of the action, if we do the following. If we say S is equal to minus d mu minus I A mu minus I A mu. I may have got the sign wrong, we'll check in a minute. pi naught square plus minus x radian. Okay? What I've tried to do is to make an action that involves a scalar field, a gauge field, and interactions between the two. Okay? However, I've tried to do it in a way that preserves the gauge invariance of the gauge field. That is, retains gauge invariance once we assign appropriate gauge transformation laws to them. So what are the gauge transformation laws under which this is invariant? See, this will be invariant if d mu minus I a mu phi transforms homogeneously. Just picks up a face, but then cancels out the monster. Okay? Now, under a gauge transformation, we've seen that a mu goes to a mu plus d mu lambda. Okay? So now, if phi goes to phi times e to pi lambda. If phi goes to phi plus e to the pi lambda, okay, then this whole thing is clearly invariant. Because when we, these are functions of x, when we act on the d mu and e to the pi lambda of x, we pick up an I d mu lambda of x. When we act on a mu, we just pick up I d mu lambda of x. The two cancel because the minus. Okay? I could have a number here. A number is called coupling constant. Okay? So this part of the action was gauge invariant. This part of the action is now also gauge invariant. Okay, so if we want to write down a theory of a scalar field interacting with a gauge field, okay, firstly, it's impossible to do that, at least in this way, if the scalar field is real. We need it to be complex. We need the scalar field without this without inducing the interaction to have a global symmetry. This global symmetry is that of U1 phase. And then, identifying the phase transformation, yeah, with the gauge transformations of the gauge field, gives us an action that has an invariance that is gated. Now, let me start with a little incident. Why are we so hung up on this gauge invariance? You know, in the last class, I started trying to discuss the path the Hilbert space interpretation of FPU. Somebody who is not familiar with the last 100 years of physics might have said, why don't we start with the action isn't that the natural generalization of the scalar action vectors? Why are you, you know, doing this crazy thing with these engineers? Should we start with this part of it? What is this path integral? Can somebody tell me the Hilbert space of this path integral?
There is no valid term of
the scalar. Mu and nu are both something. Sorry, this is the natural. Yeah, that would be crazy. What's the Hilbert space? Four scalar fields. Okay? Are all the four scalar fields identical?
Identical.
What?
What in what sense?
You know, do we get four, if we get four regular scalar fields, yeah, this is the fine theory. Because each scalar field gives you a fine theory. One of the scalar, what are four scalar fields? Name them. A0, A1, A2, A3. Is any one of these scalar fields special in it?
A0
is special. Let's try to understand why it's mutually Exactly. Firstly, we should have said that S is equal to minus of this. Okay. And now, secondly, I said this very cavalierly. I should have said, because I want Lorentz in there. I should have said this. Okay. Now, let's really write it in terms of lower things. Okay. So, you see, this thing is arranged so that when we do del 0 AI, the del 0 terms give us a plus. So what we get is del AI log squared minus grad special AI log squared. The action is the, maybe I wouldn't want to put a half. Okay, and so the action for the AI would be this. Nice. Just relabel AI finds the first action is completed. Okay, but what about the action for A0? You see, here the two minus signs cancel in the domain. This minus sign remains. So the action here is half A0 dot squared. The minus. Okay? Plus Li is 0. Okay, now there are all sorts of problems with associating a Hilbert space interpretation. This action is really the most straightforward. So the most straightforward one is now if we compute the Hamiltonian. You know, we compute what trace we compute. For these guys, we will get h is equal to sum I is equal to 1 to 3 ai squared plus pi I squared by 2. Okay? What we get here? It's exactly the same as before, except there's a minus. So here we get minus of a0 squared plus pi 0 squared by 2. And now we have the strange space where the Hamiltonian is unbounded. No, it's we were doing free field theory, who cares? Okay? But you know, we're not interested just in free field theory. Once we introduce interactions, unboundedness from below of this Hamiltonian will mean that excitations here can constantly lose, you know, constantly start rolling down the hill. Okay? This theory will be sick. There's another, we can try to cure this problem with the Hamiltonian by changing A and A dagger. That leads to complexity relativity. Okay? So basically, this theory is hard to make sense of if we preserve Lorentz invariants. Those Lorentz invariants that forced us to make the relative signs between these two guys minus. So if we want to make a Lorentz invariant theory of a massless vector field, the straightforward way of functioning does not work. Okay? What does work? What does work is very interesting. A0 is giving us problem. So what we need is make an action where A0 is a real Lagrange. Okay? Effectively. It didn't look like a Lagrange multiplier, the action, because it came there were quadratic terms. But once we went to the appropriate Hamiltonian, namely the Hamiltonian for the other three variables, it was purely linear and easier. See, that I should have emphasized, that was a very important part of our path integralization. That the Hamiltonian in AIs was linear and easier. Therefore, the integral over A0 gave you a projective. Again? So what we did was to make this action. Now, you see, this projector commuted with the Hamiltonian because it's a projector onto a space of an operation that commuted with the Hamiltonian. It was an invariance of the Hamiltonian, invariance of the Lagrangian. So this whole procedure was consistent because we have this gauge invariance.
Here the A0 comes in terms of
what do you mean fix A0? I've got a path integral.
Yes.
I've got a path integral.
Yes.
That gives me a theorem. Okay. You know, you can't.
So we
invent your own
rules. We don't have a gate choice over here. Unlike the previous.
You don't have a gate choice, but I want to emphasize, so far I've never used the word game choice. That's not the way. I don't think that's a way to think of these theories. Yeah. You know, there's no choice of anything. There's no gauge invariance, unlike the previous. But even in the previous case, we did not fix any gauge.
Yes.
We looked at the path and technique being interpreted. Okay. Here we look at the path and technique being interpreted. This is what we get. This is life. You can't do anything about it. Okay. This is going to give you a secret. Maybe some, you know, there are no noble theorems in physics. People who prove noble theorems always make assumptions. And those assumptions may or may not be correct. Okay? No, it's very dangerous. Noble theorems are very dangerous in physics. Because they often shock your imagination. Okay? So, I don't want to claim that there's a noble theorem. But nobody's ever managed to make sense of this theorem. And it doesn't look likely that anyone will. Okay? However, once we modify the action to include this gauge invariance, two things happen simultaneously. A0 medium and Lagrange multiplier, and it projected onto the subspace of gauge invariance, which existed because the theory had a gauge invariance. Okay? So, if we now want to look at a theory of this gauge field interacting with something, as we do if we want to discuss a non-Borel theory, okay, then we want to look at this interaction built in a way so that it does not destroy the gauge invariance. Because if you destroy the gauge invariance, unless something that nobody has seen for 70 years happens, okay, you're going to land up with the same theory. Okay? That's why we were so eager to make a theory of the gauge field interacting with the scalar field in a way that preserves gauge. Is this clear? Okay. So now we've got this theory, and I just want to, I'm spending too much time on this, but I just wanted to give you 1 minute on the Hilbert space interpretation of this theory. Okay? So let's play our same game, the same games. What do we get? We find integral these. Suppose we do the path integral over phi star, anything. That gives us a Hilbert space, wave functionals of AI, wave functionals of phi, wave functionals of phi star. Sorry. Okay. We're still left with the path integral over A0. Okay. We're left with the path integral over A0. Okay. And what are we going to get? Okay. So, once again, all we have to do is to evaluate the Hamiltonian. Okay? So, what is the canonical momentum constant? We've dealt, this part is unchanged. Right? From this part, what we're going to get is e to the power iht, where h is equal to pi I squared 2 plus f ij squared. And then we're going to get contributions, and then plus, what was it, del I is 0 pi I. Then we're going to get some contribution from here. Okay? What do we get from here? From here, what is the momentum conjugate of phi? Somebody?
Del and phi double, so in this case.
Let's give this a name. Let's call it V0 minus I A0. Let's do this. Okay. Yeah. On phi. Let's call that B. Let's call this D0. Similarly, we can give the name D0 plus IA0 on phi star. You see, we've done the mod square. So the I comes to the we call that D0 on phi star. Okay? So pi phi star is equal to D0 of phi, and phi phi is equal to D0 of phi star. Is this clear? Fine. Now let's see what the Hamiltonian is in this thing. Okay. A del I. Di phi star di phi. That's that. Then there is phi dot d zero phi star plus phi star dot d zero phi. Okay. And then there is minus. Minus pi. This is here. The full amplitude is the sum of these terms. Plus, minus. Yep. Okay. But now we play the same trick that we did before. We'll write this phi dot in terms of pi. Okay. So this now is equal to this check. I phi star plus di phi star di phi. Okay, and then now we added and subtracted something here. So we subtracted, so we should add again. So plus I times a zero phi d zero phi star minus I phi star minus I a zero phi star d zero phi. This is clear. What's the net conclusion? Net conclusion is that the full amplitude here. The net conclusion is that the full Hamiltonian is H is equal to Fij squared by 4 plus Ti phi Di phi Di phi star. Okay. Plus Phi star plus di phi star di phi plus a zero into actually what did we get? We got del I a zero into pi I plus a zero, so let's call this plus pi I, del I a zero into pi I plus a zero into pi d zero phi star pi minus phi star d zero phi. And these we write in terms of pi. So that's pi. This is the full amplitude. Now when we rerun our game of finding a hyperspace interpretation, okay, we have to see how this, you see now a0 acts not just here, but also here. So how, what are the wave functionals in our case now? The wave functionals are functionals of AI, phi, and of course phi star. The phi is a complex. If you have phi dependence, your phi is dependent. Now, what does this do? You see, how does this act on this wave function? What is that the generator of? Okay, this is the generator of phi going to e to the power I lambda phi. Okay? Because you see, it's just every time you see a phi, let's look at it, it's independent. Every time you see a phi, you replace it by, you kill that phi. That's what pi is. You replace the 5 with a 5, and then you add an alpha. You do it with an alpha, that's 5 goes to e to the power I, 5, I alpha 5. Every time you see a 5 scalar, you do the opposite, with a minus sign. So it's 5 e to the power I lambda 5. AC. 5 by e to the power I A0 5. 5 star to the power minus I A0 5 star. And A0 to AI to AI plus del I 5. You see, once again, this is precisely the action of a gauge transformation, including on the matter fields. Once again, our Hilbert space interpretation is very simple. You have a simple Hamiltonian. You have a simple Hamiltonian, but you have a projection. And the projection is the projection onto gauge invariant wave functions. Okay? Fine.
Why is the side star term acting only left over?
What do you mean?
The way you said it, no. 5 star by 5 star acting on 5 star won't generate this, only acting this way generates.
Wait, I didn't understand. This is an operator acting on a wave function. Okay? We want to know how it acts on a wave function. Okay? See, this is a. Okay? Okay, great. So now we understand both how the quantized scalar fields, what the path integral quantization of scalar field is, or a U1 gauge field is, U1 gauge field interacting. Okay, so that before we declare victory with our understanding of basic path integral quantization, there are two kinds of fields we haven't yet tackled. There are fermionic fields. And there are non-Hilbert gauge fields. Now let's study them one by one. We'll complete our survey of basic fields of field theory. Then we will study the path integral a little more to see where it takes us a little more. And then we'll move on to more. We'll move on to study specific. Okay.
Sir, this last A0 term, the bracket, it kind of looks like the JMU, like it's
very good, very, very, it is JMU. It is JMU. Okay? And that's a general rule. That the way that A0 in the Hamiltonian interacts with additional degrees of freedom is by the coupling A0 to A0. Okay? Now, that is why is that equivalent to what we said? That's equivalent to what we said because J0 is precisely the operator that generates the local symmetry. Okay? So, this is another way of saying what we want to say. Since this is the generator of the local symmetry, exponential action of A0 times that generates the finite symmetry, which is e to the power I alpha, phi goes to e to the power. Excellent. Okay. Other questions or comments? Okay. Now let's turn to path integral quantization, a path integral representation of phenomena. Okay. Now, as you know from your study of field, when you try to make a field theory based on the Dirac equation, okay, as you know from your study of field theory, when you try to make a field theory based on the Dirac equation, you end up getting canonical anti-commutation rather than canonical commutation. Okay? You get some sort of rule for phi bar in the Dirac equation, it's phi bar anti-commutator phi, some delta function. Okay? So what we want to do is to study a path integral that naturally represents the evolution operator in a Hilbert space that has natural anti-commuting operators. All Hilbert spaces are anti-commuting operators, it's not a big deal. But we want to find some natural. So you're going to start with the study of a very simple Hilbert space. A very simple Hilbert space that has very simple and familiar algebraic operators. The Hilbert space that we study is a two-state system. Okay? The Hilbert space has two states. Let's call them spin-off. So it can be, the spin-off needn't be any real state. Just the two states. And spin-off. So it's a two-dimensional Hilbert space. You'll agree with me that you can hardly get simple. It's only one dimensional Hilbert space. That's okay. Okay. Fine. Now on this Hilbert space, I'm going to define two operators. I will define the operator psi. I'll define the operator psi so that it is the lowering operator. So psi now is equal to 0. That's clear. The downs can be the lower. Psi and up is equal to 0. Okay? So I will also define the operator, I think, Polchinski plus chi. Polchinski's appendix, the one I referred to you to yesterday, by the way, so very useful reference for what I'm talking about now. I can exactly follow it. I'm just regurgitating what he has to do. I will define also an operator chi, which is chi on so this is the basic operator, is equal to 0, and chi on down is equal to 1. Okay? Now, these are operators which in the familiar two-state system have familiar names. Can anyone tell me what their names are? What is this one called? The lowering operator? I was thinking of even simpler, if you weren't so sophisticated. We've got a two-state system. The matrix representation of this operator is a what cross what matrix, was it? 2 cross 2 matrix. 2 cross 2 matrices have a famous basis. Pauli basis. So well, which Pauli matrix, or which linear combination of Pauli matrices is this?
Sigma minus.
Okay? So psi and chi are fancy way, a fancy names for the operators sigma minus and sigma plus. Okay? But we're gonna call them psi and chi because we call them sigma minus and sigma plus, we won't see the analogy. I mean, it'll confuse us. That's all there. Okay. Now, what is the commutation relation that psi and chi have? Okay? I'm claiming that the relation is this. Okay? You know this. You know this from Pauli matrices, but we can just check it. If this is true, it should be true on any state. Now, normally, it's tough to check state by state because there's a number of states. But here there are two, so we can just check it state by state. Okay? Let's look at the action of this on that. So these are two terms. What is this? This is psi chi plus chi psi. Okay? Chi psi annihilates down because psi annihilates down. Psi chi takes down to up. And then the psi brings up down. So this takes down to down. And it's easy to see that it also takes up to up. Okay? So this is the identity operator. Psi, anti-commutator chi is the identity operator. And so our two operators, psi and chi, obey anti-commutation, canonical anti-commutation relations. So the question we're asking is this. Suppose we've got on this Hilbert space, we've got the evolution operator in IHT, where H is any function of psi and chi.
This particular thing is just an observation. Does it follow from some Hilbert? I mean, the way you do quantization by promoting
first of brackets into a commutation relation. You, do you have a picture of some of the computer?
Wait, where are the Poisson brackets? Where
are
we'll see an analogy soon. But at the moment we can't. Right? All we've done is look at two-state systems and see that there are two. There's no classical, there's nothing. The aim is to build a classical formulation of the two-state system. Okay? Which seems like a crazy thing to do because, you know, two-state seems very quantum. Okay? And the aim is to somehow find some way of thinking of the two-state system, classically. And we're going to find, as you know, that you can't do it in the ordinary way, but you can do it in some formal hull. Hang on, ask the question. Okay. So, this is a great system because, it implements static commutation relations. But notice it's not far from what we want. Why is that the case? You see, you remember that in the Dirac system, we've got anti-commutation relations that look very complicated. You know, that some field anti-commuting and some other field position. But you go to the Fourier basis, and the anti-commutation relations just become A alpha B A. Delta of minus k. Some I is to come. Okay? So, and with the delta of theta. Okay? So, mode by mode, the Dirac system implements precisely this commutation relation. Mode by mode, the Dirac system is precisely a two-state system. Because the Pauli extension is every mode is either occupied. Okay? So once we understand how to work with two-state systems, ramping up the Dirac system is very easy. So the two-state system is to Fermionic path integrals what the theory of, you know, one x was to bosonic path integrals. It's the simplest path integral, which once you understand completely, allows for trivial generalization to everything. Now let's deal with this part. So what we can do is a lot of formal data. So let's see. First thing that we do is to define a state. We define the state psi to be the following. Psi is equal to let me first define it and then we talk about it. Equal to down plus psi times. Okay. Now, this would be a normal state in a Hilbert space. Psi was a complex number. Now we're going to do something really crazy. Okay.
This is too low, right?
What?
Psi time term will be decided function.
Oh, I'm sorry. Let me put at operators. And now we're going to have a number. Just like the position operator, sometimes it's denoted by x, and its eigenvalue is also denoted by x. Okay? Good. But what I'm going to do now is a bit crazy sounding. What I'm going to do is to say, let psi not be a number, but instead be an anti-commutator. Now, what does that mean? What is that? Okay. I'm going to define some abstract algebra and its rules, and then we'll think a little more about what it means. Okay, but first, hang on before you jump to the conclusion that all this is mathematics and you want to do physics instead. Hang on for a minute. We're going to define some sort of algebra of anti-commuting numbers. These anti-commuting numbers are
let's say psi 1, psi 2, psi 3, psi n, n could be infinite. The algebra of these numbers is just the following. They anti-commute with each other. Psi 1, psi 2, is equal to psi 2. Okay, in particular that means psi 1 is equal to minus psi 1 psi 1. I mean this is psi I is equal to, which is equal to 0. So psi squared is to 0. Okay, this is so far just abstract definitions. We'll talk about it a little more. I will also define an integral of that. Okay? By a strange rule, the integral, let's first deal with one number, that p psi 1 is equal to. An integral d psi of psi is equal to. That's the definition. Okay?
The first thing, psi I psi is minus psi j psi.
Minus psi j psi.
Thank you. Okay, so that's my definition of the integral. And I'm going to, just as a notational device, also define psi d psi to be equal to minus of d psi psi. Pure notational. But and the position of the d psi is important in the integral, just notational. Okay. I also define differentiation of the integral. By the way, why did I stop at defining integral of 1 and integral of psi? Why did I also define integral of sine of psi? Because every function of psi is a linear combination of 1 and psi. Because psi square is 0, therefore psi cube is 0. Okay, so if I know how to integrate 1 and psi, I know how to integrate. Okay, then d by d psi is defined as the integral. Okay, d by d psi of 1 is equal to 0. By d psi of psi is equal to 2. Okay. Now note that these definitions are pretty strange. In particular, the integral of 1 is the same as the derivative, and the integral of psi is the same as the derivative. So integral and derivative are basically the same thing. Okay? And it's just definitions. Now the fact that integral and derivative are basically the same thing immediately allows me to show that these definitions obey the rules of partial integration. Why is that? Because integral times derivative is derivative squared. And derivative squared of any linear function vanishes. For every function of psi is a linear function. Derivative of the psi term is 1 and the 1 term is 0. Okay? Crazy definitions, but okay, let's go. Okay? Last thing. More conventions. If I write d theta 1 into d theta n, these are all anti-commuting, right? Then theta n minus 1, theta 1, this guy. So, the d theta kills the theta just next to it. It's important if I have the other order. I would have got minus. Okay, so the rule for integrals, you know, the position of these d's is important. And the d hits the theta nearest to it. That's the rule. Okay? Fine. Now, let's
little bit and ask if there are any familiar objects that we could be that obey these anti-computing. And just to reassure you, that that this is indeed the case. Okay? If you wanted to build a familiar representation of this anti, it's very easy. Okay? Just to reassure you, this is some, not some crazy thing that cannot be realized. And this is presumably how you implement this algebra on a computer. If you wanted to do it, If you didn't know how to teach the computer to obey abstract rules, but you wanted to, do some spinner or some anti-commuting algebra, Mathematica, using the functions that Mathematica already has. Okay? What would you do? Well, what do you want is something such that all these guys anti-commute with each other? Okay. Okay. First, if we just one side, okay, we already know how to do that. The work in a 2 cross 2 Hilbert space. Okay? Psi is equal to sigma plus and chi is equal to because we want that to end. There may be a better way of doing it, but let me give you this way. Work in a 4 cross 4 Hilbert space. Okay? That has the tensor structure of V1 tensor, where V1 and V2 are both 2 cross 2. Okay? So then the representation, for instance, that psi was equal to sigma plus tensor sigma 3 and chi was equal to sigma I'll get this right in a minute. Identity tensor sigma plus. This would work, right? Because this thing squares to 0. Because sigma plus squares to 0. This thing squares to 0. Because sigma plus squares to 0. This part will be, identity. So, these two guys are identity. And then, if you want to build many different, sizes, okay, if you want to build many different sizes, then you would, you could build by tensoring more and more of these things. And if you try it hard, you'd be able to find representations of this derivative and integral by appropriate traces of these operators multiplied by. Now, what I want to do is just to find a familiar representation of this object. We define these objects. Okay, we define these objects that have these this algebra. Now, you can ask, given an abstract algebra, it's useful to look for representations of that.
Oh, so we need to figure out basis.
Just some matrix representation. Can you find some Hilbert space, some set of matrices that represent the algebra of these anti-commuting variables? And I'm saying it's easy to do. You can do it. This may not, the way I looked at it was not, may not have been the most economic idea. But you can easily find matrix representations of the algebra. The one thing to note is that as you, if you try to take this representation and enlarge it into more and more and more anti-commuting variables, each time you add a new variable, you tensor product some new space. So
So the representation that you build will be in a space whose dimensionality will grow exponentially with the number of anti-commuting variables. Okay? So this representation, while concrete, will not be easy to work with. Will not be easy to work with when you have a significant number of anti-commuting variables. But you know, if you did this or the correct version of this or the best version of this, and implemented it on Mathematica for three variables, any expression that you have in terms of phis, you can let Mathematica's matrix manipulation routines, you know, do the job for you. So all I'm saying is that these anti-commuting variables are not that unfamiliar. You can just think of them as matrices on a Hilbert space.
The simplest representation of this algebra is the one with which we start. It's I equals sigma plus I sigma minus.
No, that doesn't have the. We want them to anti commute. And those matrices anti commute to work. Perhaps the simplest representation. Perhaps the simplest representation would be psi is equal to sigma 1 and chi is equal to sigma 2. This would probably be the simplest representation.
Is there some rule about how many values each variable is? Yes. Where is
sigma? Sorry. You're right. Space for it. Sorry. What I wrote down before was that. Sorry. What were you saying?
Is there some rule about how many values the variable can take?
What do you mean values?
Any variable psi can be either I tens of sigma 1 or sigma plus and sigma 3. If you could find more matrices that anti commute, would you allow that to be a set value, possible value?
Maybe you're asking whether every operator in the Hilbert space can be built as functions of these thetas. Is that equal? I didn't understand your question.
Suppose you found two anti-commuting matrices. Suppose you find, you could find four here. Right.
If you could find four here, then on this space, you would be able to build the algebra of psi 1, psi 2, psi 3, psi 4. But if you use that space to build the algebra of just psi 1 and psi 2, then what probably would be the case? Yeah. Okay. We could ask the following question. I probably have done the most efficient thing. We thought about how to do this more efficiently. I probably have not done the most efficient thing. Right? I'll tell you next class what the most efficient thing is. Okay. Anyway, I probably have not done the most efficient thing. But you could ask the following question. You could ask, in this space, do functions, arbitrary functions, of psi 1 and... We could start with just one variable.
Can I take a seat?
Yeah, please do.
Wait for one minute, sir. I will change it.
Just so that you would not feel that what we're doing is very abstract. That's not connected to the areas, you know. Let me start with one variable. Okay? Psi can easily be represented just a sigma plus. Okay? That's clear? Okay, and now any function, so we could have identity and sigma plus. Identity is the representation of 1, sigma plus is the representation of psi. With one variable, everything's very clear. Sigma plus squares to 0. Okay, now we've got two variables. Okay, that's why we look at this tensor problem. Now you might have thought, let's just do everything identity on one space. You know, let's just do really a tensor product of these two representations. But that won't work because we want the two sides to mutually anti-commute. Okay? But that's easily achieved. All you have to find is one object in this space that anti-commutes with this guy. That object, sigma 3, is an example of that object. Okay? And therefore, if you do psi is equal to sigma plus tensor identity, chi is equal to sigma 3 tensor sigma plus. This will work. Because this will now make sure that the two mutually independent. Okay? If you wanted one more, so say we had psi 1, psi 2. If we did psi 3, we do a tensor identity, and here we do sigma 3, tensor, sigma 3, tensor, sigma plus. That will work. Okay? All these squared to 0 because of sigma plus squared to 0. All these anti commute because let's look at this guy with this guy, for instance. Okay? These two sigma 3s commute, these two guys commute, this guy anti commute. Okay? I think this is probably the most efficient representation. Okay? It's clear that you can generalize this to n size. But,
okay, so in the representation for two variables, we could also write psi 1 is equal to sigma plus tensor producted with sigma 3 and psi 2 is equal to sigma 3 tensor producted.
No. If we did both sigma 3s, they would commute.
No, not both sigma 3s. Sigma
you
plus
choose.
Sigma 3 and sigma. So there is a degeneracy between the
representation. We're not saying it's a unique representation. All we want is some representation that implements the algebra. Yeah. Notice that you cannot build every operator in this. I should have done this. Right. Notice that you cannot build every operator in this Hilbert space as functions of size. Why not? Let's count the dimensions. What is the dimensionality of a Hilbert space? If we've got n size, it's clear it's 2 to the n. That's the dimensionality of Hilbert space. What's the dimensionality of operator space? Total number of operators you can build on this Hilbert space is 2 to the n cross 2 to the n matrices. So that's the net dimensionality of the operator space. What is the net dimensionality of the space of functions you can build out of psi 1 to psi n? Well, any function is a monomial, is a polynomial. Psi 1 is either present or not, the two options. Psi 2 is either present or not, so the two options. So of the 2 to the n times 2 to the n possible operators on this huge Hilbert space, only 2 to the n of them are built out of functions of size. This is why it's a pretty inefficient representation. But I don't think with matrices you can do it. Or maybe you can approach. This is one representation, not a terribly efficient. You're using much larger spaces of operators than you than the things you then those that you will ever need. Yeah. Okay? If you played around, you would be able to find representations of the integral and the derivative operator in terms of traces. But I'm not going to try to do that here for you. Okay, for instance, for one variable, you would multiply by sigma minus and then take a trace. Sigma minus and then take a trace, and you could play around with more variables. You can represent these rules in matrices and traces. It's not a big deal. However, you don't need to. The rules stand for themselves. Okay, and we will never represent them in terms of matrices and traces unless you get confused. If you get confused about what something means, this is sometimes a good way to do. Because it's concrete. It's not some abstract. Okay, so let's move on. Okay, now we started this whole discussion because I wanted to define this state. And in this state, the psi is an anti-commutator. Okay. Now, I'm going to look at some properties of psi. First property, psi hat times psi. Okay, so you remember psi was the lowering operator. So psi kills this. Psi hat kills this. Psi hat makes this object. You know, psi hat is some operator. Oh, wait. Let me call this.
Not that it matters. Psi is just an operator that acts in Hilbert space. Okay. But I'll try as far as possible to remove this. So psi is some operator that acts on down, up to give you down. Okay? But that is exactly equal to right? Because we wanted only down times psi on the right. Okay? But psi squared is zero. Now, the next thing I'm going to do, I'm sorry, I'll take 10 minutes. Does anyone have a class they have to go for? I'll take 10 minutes to finish this. This part. Okay. The next thing that we want to discuss the next thing we want to define is this object. Okay? Now, I define it in the following way. I define psi prime is equal to psi x. Okay, we'll soon find the representation for this psi. But even before we do that, let's find modulation for this one. You see, notice the following thing. Suppose we have d psi of psi minus psi prime times some function of psi. This is equal to the same function. How do you know this is true? Let's just check it.
Yes.
The most general function of psi is a plus b psi. Okay? If we do a plus b psi, the path that is psi prime a is 0. Because the rule for integration says d psi is not 0 only if it's a psi. Okay? So, this b psi, the path that is b psi psi a is non-zero, and that according to our rules gives us a. What about this guy? This is d psi minus psi prime times b psi. That's the only possible non-zero guy. So we move this through that way. That gives us minus psi. Okay, and that then kills the psi. So that's it. Okay.
So this is very similar to the function which we usually do.
Exactly. Very good. So that's the reason we wanted to make this definition. That this object here is the fermionic representation of a Dirac delta function. So we want to find those states that are, you know, have this orthogonality property, like in position space. Now, if we implement usual inner product between up and down, that is, up is orthogonal to up, is up, down, inner product is 0, up is 1, down is 1. Actually, in what I'm doing here, I don't really need that anymore. Just to be familiar, not to abstract. I'm going to implement that. We find an explicit representation of this side. Let's find that. So, what do you see?
Does this not indicate that the norm state size is equal? Psi is good. So indicate that the norm state psi is
yes. Except that this psi here will not be the Hermitian conjugate of psi. Let's see what this psi is. Okay. You see, this definition here, okay, it's a definition of this graph, okay, and maybe it's a use of notation, but it's not
So it will be the graph corresponding to the get sign. At least not under the tree. Hang on for a minute.
Have we changed the wordplay sentence? It doesn't seem to work in the top end of the
what does it mean?
Like defining the conjugate bra like this. I don't think.
This is, just think of this as a name.
Yeah, that's right. That's the thing, is the inward space, have we expanded in some ways?
No.
It's the same space.
But when not, you say, well, what may be causing the confusion? That this, with the usual inner product, this psi is not the, what is it called? The bra corresponding to the state psi. It's just some different object. Let's work it out for this. Okay. So, this psi, wherever it is equal to some A down plus B times up. And we want this relation to be true when we take this object on down plus up and side. So the first thing that we want is that we want to get a psi. So that works provided this is one. Okay, so that up to up equals the psi. And then if we wanted to get a minus psi prime, so that works provided this is minus psi. Okay, so with the usual inner product, psi is equal to minus psi. That's called this. Psi prime is equal to minus psi down plus. This is with the usual inner product, okay? Actually, there is an inner product that's better suited to this notation and is better suited to some applications in physics. Okay? And everything I do here actually is independent of what this inner product is. It just depends on this definition of this, the product sign. But just so that it doesn't get too abstract, I'm going to use the familiar inner product. So that would happen. Okay. Now, I'm sorry, this is going to sound a bit crazy till we get the answer. It sounds beyond motivated. Hang on. Okay. Now, something that's easy to check, either with or without using the inner product. Let's check it without the use of the inner. I mean, without the specific representation. This is plus and this is minus. Right? Thank you. Does it work now?
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. Okay, let's check that this is true. Okay? In order to check it's true, what I'm going to do is to act it on a state. Okay, if it's true for every psi state, it's true. So let me act it on the state chi. This is psi
at the edge.
Yeah,
this should be one d psi.
Thank you. Anyway, these psi, let's act on chi.
Okay, but by our definition, this was psi d psi into psi minus chi. So then, remember that d psi in the psi minus psi prime, okay, was just for this part, which is do the integral. This gives us. This is clear. Okay, because inside it's some function of psi, function of psi. Okay, so we've got identity. Okay, now. Okay. Now one last thing. What I want to do is to find the matrix elements psi psi prime of all operators in my two dimensional universe. So the operator psi hat and chi. Okay, so firstly, operator psi hat. That's very easy because we know that psi hat on psi prime is equal to psi prime times psi. So this is equal to psi prime. Okay. The question is, how does it work for chi?
Right.
So this left hand side is just a very fancy way of saying minus 1. Okay? The right hand side is also a very fancy way of saying minus 1. Okay? Let's check. I'm sorry, this sounds very unmotivated. And will for another 5 minutes. Then you'll see why it's going to. Okay. The right hand side is also a very fancy way of saying minus 1. Let's check that. Okay. Let's just expand that. The right hand side is minus chi 1 plus chi psi prime minus psi. And then the Taylor expansion stops. That's what the exponential means. It's Taylor expansion. Okay. B chi into 1 is minus 1. B chi into chi is 0. So this is equal to minus 1. So this is a true identity. Okay? One more thing that I want to verify is that chi prime is also equal to minus of B chi exponential of chi in the psi prime. That is, I didn't have the chi hat and I don't put the chi. Okay, let's check that. This we know. Can somebody remind me, was it psi minus psi prime or psi prime?
Psi minus psi prime.
Let's check that. It's equal to that. So that's minus chi in a 1. But that's 0 because integral of d chi with 1 is 0. So if you get the 1, so it's just a linear term. So chi into psi prime minus psi, that gives us 1 minus psi prime minus psi, psi prime. Okay. So, what have we concluded? Because any function of chi hat, is a linear function because chi hat squares to 0 as an operator, we've concluded that psi times f of chi hat times psi prime is equal to minus g by f of chi exponential of chi psi prime. And of course, the much more trivial statement that psi times g of psi hat, that's psi prime, is equal to g of psi prime. Right? Psi. And these are the two relations. Is this clear? Okay. Now, what should the analogy? Okay. I know you might remember that when we discussed bosonic path integrals, okay, we had x prime, and it was difficult to know what to make of functions' momentum. So, if we had some function of momentum, of the momentum operator, okay? If we had some function of the momentum operator, what we did was we did x, f of p, times, and then insert a complete set of momentum instants. Okay? Then we let this just be f of p. F of p times, then we got the e to the power I p x minus x prime. Okay?
So we have this formula that any function of momentum between two position eigenstates was equal to that function of momentum times e to the power I t x minus x prime dp. We've got an extremely similar formula. Right? Any function of chi at, okay, any function of chi at between two psi states is equal to d chi f of chi exponential of chi psi prime. Okay, now since we've gone so late, what I'm going to do is to leave for the rest as an exercise. I'll tell you what to do. I'll ask you to do it before next class. And I'll tell you how much trouble I do. Okay, now, what do we want to do? Now, what we want to do is clear. We've got this fermionic path integral. I mean, we've got this fermionic evolution of it. Even for minus I h. We do exactly what we did for the bosons. We break up time into some t0, t1, t0, t1, up to tn. Okay? We've got all these tn minus 1s. We break this up into product over n e to the power minus I h delta tn. Exactly like we did. Okay? Let's suppose that what we want to evaluate is psi, I don't know, let's call it mu nu. Suppose we want to evaluate this. Okay, let me break it up into mu of this kind. Between each of these operators, we insert the identity integral psi d psi psi. Is equal to identity. We use the fact that at each time step, h is a function of chi hat and psi hat. And that because we have infinitesimal time steps, we can separate it into an exponential of, you know, some function of chi hat, that function of psi hat. Okay? Using in this case the fact that, you know, all functions are equal. Anyway, so you do that, and then use these relations. Okay, so these Hamiltonians are each chi and psi. Okay, the path that is the function of psi hat. Where is that going? The path that's the function of psi hat. Okay, this psi hat, psi prime. F of psi hat psi prime is equal to F of psi prime. And for the chi dependence, you use this formula. Okay? So what do we get in the end? See, at each step we have to introduce a path integral over psi for the completeness formula and a path integral over chi to represent matrix element of chi. So at each time step we have an integral over psi and integral over chi. Okay? This clearly in the continuum limit just like before is going to become chi psi dot. Okay? So up to signs that you have to keep very careful track of. You see, what you're going to get is d psi 1, d psi n, p chi, chi 0, p chi 1, to p chi n, exponential of chi psi dot minus h of chi. Okay. Because an overall is like the I will come. this was really, this didn't happen. Now if you do this carefully, actually this has minus sign, because this was minus sign, because this was beginning of this one. Okay, so and this is in fact correct. We just have to check about the integration. Up to plus or minus this is correct. Okay? Which I'll ask you to do. This is the path integral representation for the two state system. Okay. Because the two state system is a first order system, there's actually no distinction between the Hamiltonian and Lagrangian formulation. I mean, it's not. Better to say there is no better representation. You see, the point of the Hamiltonian formulation is to make a second order system a first order system. See, the point of Hamiltonian classical mechanics is to take Lagrangian classical mechanics, which is second order, and make it first order. If you've got a set of equations of motion, they're already first order, and you already, you know, there's nothing left to do. So, this is the final answer for this. It's not like we, you know, in the case of the bosonic thing, we got an answer like this, and then we integrated out the cuts. Okay? We're not going to try to do anything about it. We're just going to stop this. Okay? This is the thing that is going to make contact with the path integral representation of the Dirac field. In field. What is the basic idea? If you have two anti-commuting variables, one of which has a time derivative, the other does not. That's first order framework. Then, this, so what is the translation formula? The translation formula is that this path integral firstly implements a transition amplitude in the Hilbert space. What is the Hilbert space? The Hilbert space is the Hilbert space that implements psi and psi hat is equal to 1. What is the Hamiltonian in the Hilbert space? H of chi hat psi. Now we've done this with the two state system. But if you had two state systems, we could do something extremely similar, except we could have this. So this I'm going to call path integral. You would have a path integral over psi 1 and psi 2, chi 1 and chi 2. And once again, you would represent, you know, the algebra that went, this is equal to 1, so that's it. Psi 2, psi, okay, in general, you would represent this. M, n is equal to n psi. Okay, this would work for two state systems, m two state systems. You put a number of two state systems. But as you guys know, the Dirac Lagrangian, at least the free Dirac Lagrangian, this is the Dirac Lagrangian, when written in terms of the momentumness, is precisely of this form with an infinite number of different harmonic oscillators, or even in position basis. Okay? It's precisely in this form. It's got two anti-commuting variables with first order and time. So, what we can do is the following. If we wrote down the Dirac Lagrangian, we'll come to this in detail.
Can I just
say,
if we just forcefully do the chi integral, we should in principle get back the Dirac Lagrangian.
No, the Dirac Lagrangian is this Lagrangian. Okay. Hang on for a minute. See, suppose we have the action. S is equal to psi bar d slash psi. Okay, let's see about it. I get my factors of I and so on, right? Plus
right now just focus people. Okay? This, now, if I do the following path attempt, I do the path attempt for d sidebar, d side, exponential of I integral sidebar then slash plus n. Psi. What Hilbert space am I working on? I'm working on a Hilbert space that implements the canonical, that implements the following anti-computational conditions. So I'll regard this chi bar, the psi bar, as the envelope of this chi. And this psi as the analog of this sky. The gamma zero here, as you know, the usual thing, right? But the gamma zero kills the gamma zero in the bar. Okay, so this will give us the commutation relation psi dagger, okay, or psi bar gamma zero, let's go at x. Psi at y should be equal to delta of x. If we implement this with psi bar and psi being path anti-commuting path integrals, one path integral at each point in space separately for psi bar and psi, and then also we have to deal with the indices. We come to all of that. But this is precisely the anti-computation you guys used when you quantized the Dirac field in your first study of this subject. So what we have concluded is that the path integral representation of the Dirac action gives us what you guys deduced was the correct thing to do on whatever it was. Okay? Provided you take this path integral to be a path integral over anti-commuting things. Is this clear? This is the main point I wanted to make, because I know it's slightly boring in an algebraic class. But okay. Yeah. Okay, I think I'll stop here for half an hour over time. I'll stop here. Of course, thank you for questions.
The difference between this and what we did earlier was that we had assumed the anti-computation relations beforehand. Like what we did earlier was we assumed the ETCRs and then we do whatever. Over here, the difference is that these come out as a result of the path integral.
Yeah. Our analysis of the Dirac system was sort of similar to the analysis of the electromagnetic system. What we're doing is this. We're saying, I give you this path integral. And I tell you the path integral of anti-commuting force. And then I ask you, what is the right Hilbert space interpretation of the path integral? Okay? So, given this path integral, since we understand how to interpret the path integral over a single anti-commuting force, really 2, psi and chi, it's a simple generalization of that. So we know that this path integral, when sliced, gives us the Hilbert space that implements this attribute. On that Hilbert space, it computes a transition amplitude. Okay, what is the transition amplitude? The transition amplitude is simply exponential of e to the power minus I h, when h is that part of whatever enters here that is independent of time derivatives. But this is the standard analysis of the Dirac. Meaning, when you guys worked out canonical quantization of the Dirac convention, this was your answer. Okay? So what we've done is this. Starting with this path integral, we sliced it and found a Hilbert space interpretation, and we find that it's exactly what you guys are familiar with. So if our goal is to find, if we, in my way of thinking, the path integral is often both more convenient as well as in some ways perhaps more fun. Okay.
and more convenient the thinking of starting with canonical quantization. No. So path integral defines a quantum theory. And that's great. But you can't be satisfied with just saying that it defines it. You know that it's a very important structure in quantum mechanics that is the Hilbert space time family. So if you write down a path integral, so the first thing you have to ask is what Hilbert space does that path integral define? What is the Hamiltonian in that Hilbert space? Okay? So what we did here was write down this this path integral based on the familiar Dirac action. But declare that the variable factor. This was our definition of the path integral. And then we asked, what system is it? What is the Hilbert space? What is the Hamiltonian? And we found that the answer was exactly what you guys studied when you did the Hilbert. Okay? So this is the path integral representation of the Dirac function. Okay. So we'll talk a little more about this next class, about the Dirac stuff, a little more. And in the next class, we will either discuss non-obedient gauge theories or perhaps let's discuss non-obedient gauge theories. So we will have completed a survey of the kinds of path integrals that we are interested in this course. And then we will study the path integral. Any other questions? Okay.
Yeah.